Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. Mary Mapes, the embattled producer of the Rathergate TV program, the one for which Dan Rather was, shall we say, fired, is on a book tour, a national book tour. She's been on all the great TV shows. And are we ever lucky? Because she fit the digital age into her schedule. Now, if there ever was a digital age story, this is it. This is a story of how the bloggers got CBS. Or did they get CBS? And here to discuss that issue with us tonight is Mary Mapes. Mary, thanks very much for coming by and fitting us in your very busy schedule.
Oh, I'm thrilled to be here.
Now, I want to show your book up to the camera, if I may. Truth and Duty, the President and the Privilege of Power. I told Mary, before she went on, it really ought to be how the bloggers got CBS. But anyway, we're supposed to work into that question. Now, The bloggers. The first thing the bloggers did with respect to your program, which you produced and Dan Rather narrated, and we all know what that program was about. That was a program in which we had documents about President Bush's service in the Texas Air National Guard, and you brought new information to the table, including the fact that his reports had been sugarcoated, he had been ordered for a physical, he did not show up, and it put a whole extra dimension on the Bush National Guard service, his Air Force service. Now, when the bloggers saw that, the first thing they did, they said it was a forgery. And it was a forgery for two reasons. One, there was a little the, T-H, that was in the typing up here. And the proportional spacing was not to the bloggers' liking. And they said that this proves what Mary Mapes did was a forgery because they didn't have typewriters that could do that in those days. Were they right?
No, they weren't even close to being right. They were embarrassingly wrong, and they continued to insist that it's like the big lie. If it's wrong and you say it loud enough and long enough, you can make it right in people's heads. And I think you can fool a lot of the people some of the time, and that's what happened.
And why weren't they right?
Well, for one thing, in the months since I've been gone from CBS, I've continued to work on the story. I got a cache of documents from the Texas Air National Guard Camp Mabry, the inter-office memos, which is really what the Killian documents were. And I've got a number of them with proportional spacing from 68, 69, and 70, well before the memos that I presented had proportional spacing. So there it is, you know, right there in black and white. It's right in the headquarters where this came from, where the Killian memos came from. So I would think that they would accept that, although I'm not sure they will. And also proportional spacing, just doing research and talking with analysts, that started in the 1940s.
Let's remind us who Killian was.
Killian, Lieutenant Colonel Jerry Killian, was Bush's commanding officer of the 111th Fighter Interceptor Squadron, which was under the 147th Fighter Group at Ellington Airfield in Houston.
And he was the one who wrote the documents, right?
That's exactly right.
He's
purportedly the author.
And some of the other key players we had was William Burkett. Mm-hmm. And can you remind us who William Burkett was?
Bill Burkett was a man.
That's
question.
That's a Manhattan pronunciation.
Right, or Houston versus Houston.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, Bill Burkett was a member of the National Guard, Texas National Guard, until about 1997 or 98, I believe. He had been brought in to do something involving, they've always had problems with ghost soldiers, and he came in as part of a team to do some reworking and revamping on numbers and, sort of realigning the system, which had always been very troubled. Burkett ended up getting in fights with a lot of people, and he can be quite a cantankerous fellow, so that doesn't surprise me in the least, but he claimed in 1997 that he saw a scrubbing of Bush's documents, overheard a conversation in which I think Dan Bartlett or Joe Alba, two of the governor, then Governor Bush's aides, had ordered a scrubbing at Camp Mabry. And he'd gone public with that. And then I sought him out and got the documents from him.
Well, let us go back to whether it's a forgery or not. After the report came out, there was a panel formed. And the panel was formed with Dick Thornburgh, who is the former Attorney General of the United States, and Lou Bacardi, who is the former President and General Manager of Associated Press. And now, did this panel find these documents were forgeries?
No. Despite the fact that CBS had to have spent millions of dollars on the panel, and I think they desperately wanted to prove them to be forged, they were not able to do that. Another of the things the bloggers claimed was that these documents could easily be reproduced in WordPerfect on a computer, and they said that it was virtually identical, the key, of course, being virtually, which is, you know, not good in horseshoes or document analysis. So they couldn't find them to be forged, and I took some comfort in that.
And did the report look at this argument about the and the proportional, and they couldn't find that to be true either?
No, that's right. Superscript was around long before that's what they call the little TH, or you'd have an ST or an RD, something lifted up above the line. That was around a long time before.
So there's absolutely, so in retrospect, there's absolutely no proof that these documents are forgeries?
No, there's none.
How do you explain the Washington Post, with Howie Kurtz, who's the great media critic, ran this huge blown-up page in which he said that the documents are forgeries? Now that all the dust has settled and there is no proof that there are forgeries, where is he? Has he called up and said, I'm sorry, I made a mistake?
No.
How do you account for, what's going on with the media here? They just accept the big lie?
They do accept the big lie, and I think here's why. Howard Kurtz, God love him, I don't know when the last time was he left the office to do some actual reporting. Howard is a Google journalist. Googleism. Instead of journalism, where where you want to know something, you Google it, and all you get is what someone else has said, and then rather than reporting, you repeat. And that's what we have way too much of in our culture and in the culture of news today. And it's why we don't have more investigative reporting, because everybody can just Google something.
Well, it's hurt journalism. You just follow what somebody else has done.
That's right.
Okay, now, I just throw my own two cents in here. I've read everything. I've read your book. I bet you I'm the only person who's interviewed you who has read this book.
Maybe true.
Right. I've read the report. I'm the only person who's interviewed you who has read every word of the report and read the book.
That has to be true.
That has to be true. Okay. From my own point of view, I don't think there's any proof that these documents were forged. Now, you can turn the thing over, which I really don't want to. Can you prove they're true? We'll get into that a little bit. But in terms of the main attack the bloggers made against you, I don't think it's true, just from my own opinion. Now, speaking of truth, now that we've established that point, is the information in these documents true?
It appears to be, according to everyone who was there at the time, except for President Bush, but then he doesn't really answer questions about it. So a number of people in the unit have really said that this was true, this is how Killian felt, these were the actions he took, and this is what he did. And I always found it very difficult to figure out why someone would forge the truth. That doesn't happen. You forge a lie. You don't forge reality.
Well, let's go into that with some particularity, because just from my point of view, following this closely as I have, I really did not get the full force of your argument until I'd read this book. And one of the reasons for that is that your program didn't have the three legs to the stool that you always need when you go on TV with this type of information. Now, when you sat there and put this show together, you say in here you had three legs to your stool. What were those legs?
Well, the same thing that you have with any good investigative story. The document analysis was one of them, and I really felt weakest probably about that, because it's a very subjective art science. You get into the whole field of expert courtroom testimony, and everyone knows you can have he says, she says, so much with that. But I went with two people. I had four analysts. One told me she needed originals to make a judgment. The other was concerned about the little TH. And the other two, who had the most experience, one of them, Jim Pierce, 34 years in the field, trained by the FBI, felt very strongly that these were very probably authentic, did not see anything that indicated they'd not been put together at the time. Then I had what for me was much stronger evidence. I'm not a document analyst, and I don't even play one on the internet, which a lot of the people apparently do. But I'm a reporter, so I wanted information. So the group I was with, working on the story with, we vetted the bejesus out of these documents, looking for you know, the little details that give up forgeries, whether it's the Niger forgeries or some financial forgery somebody is trying to pull off. We looked at dates, we looked at service number, address, we looked at rankings, we looked at the 1972 Air Force manual paragraph and page. We went through these things like crazy and I couldn't find anything. Then I took the old documents and meshed them with these new Killian documents, thinking they would rub up against each other and I would find something that indicated that this was a problem. But I didn't. Instead, they just meshed perfectly. So these were either brilliantly done forgeries, and then I went on and had the corroboration of General Bobby Hodges.
Okay, no, so the three stools were Hodges.
Hodges.
Meshing.
And
expert. And
meshing,
two
vetting,
expert witnesses.
Yeah. Right.
Okay, so now, and who was Bobby Hodges and how did he help this your mental process before you go on?
Bobby Hodges was the general in charge of the 147 fighter group at Ellington Airfield. In other words, he was Lieutenant Colonel Killian's boss. I called him on Labor Day night, read him every word of the memos, and said, "Is any of this familiar to you?" And he said, "These are very familiar to me. This is exactly how Colonel Killian felt." He said Colonel Killian was a hard nose who believed that the weekend guys, meaning the pilots like Bush, should pull the same, should have the same standards as the weekday guys, the full timers. He was angry that Bush left to go to Alabama. He ordered Bush to take a physical. Bush didn't take it, and this was how Killian responded.
So basically, what Hodges did is he confirmed all the information.
Everything the documents held.
So that the information was true in his opinion. Mm-hmm. And he is a good position to have that opinion because, after all, he was the boss of Killian, as you point out. And then you bolstered it up with opinions from the code experts. Mm-hmm. And then you did a meshing analysis. Now, when we say meshing analysis, people will say, "Well, what are we talking about?" Mm-hmm. That sounds like something people do out in Iowa, mesh flour or whatever.
Thrash or something.
Thrash flour.
I think that's what they do.
Is that what they do?
I don't know.
I don't know what goes on.
I don't know. Iowa, you wouldn't believe.
You're west of the Mississippi, so
that's right.
You live in Texas, actually.
I do live in Texas, but I'm from Washington State.
You grew up in Washington State, and you had a privileged liberal background, which you ought to explain to everybody.
Right. I grew up on a family. We bragged that we were one of the first failing family farms.
What do you think, by the way, just off the subject a little bit, when Attorney General Bacardi mm-hmm. says, "Mary Mapes, are you a liberal?"
Right, it was odd. I mean, I did say
he
to
did
him,
say
I,
that I, in your in the investigation.
I made the joke to him. Are you asking me? Am I now, or have I ever been a liberal? I mean, the old line from the McCarthy hearings, completely, unsmiling. No one thought that was amusing.
Okay,
I thought it was terrible.
That was an aside. Now we're trying to describe what the meshing analysis is. Now, what you did there, because I've actually read the meshing documents. Now I'll bet you. I'm the only person who's read the meshing documents, okay? And they're in your book. Mm-hmm. And what you did was you went back in time. One thing you haven't told us is when you started following this story. Remember, now we're talking about a 2004 TV production. When did you start following this
1999.
Story? Why were you following it for so long?
Well, I was based in Texas, for one thing. I mean, that's the primary reason. It was in, it was proximity. Not politics. The CBS Evening News Bureau down there always received phone calls from, someone on the other end saying, "You've really got to look at Bush's National Guard background." And I think in Texas, it was and remains very common knowledge that this candidate, Bush, when he was a potential candidate, was trailing a lot of baggage with him from the National Guard.
And you had all these documents. You went Freedom of Information. You had them all lined up. And you had some documents that no one else had. Mm-hmm. You had one document that showed Bush had trouble landing his plane and probably been docked because of incompetence, as much as anything, didn't
Well, it was interesting. AP ultimately got some of the flight records also that showed...
Yeah, but that was afterwards, wasn't it?
They got the flight records showing that, boy, you can... I mean, people actually drink and have fistfights about this stuff, but what he... He had difficulty landing the F-102 number of times, and that was the document AP got that I thought was really fascinating. And what I did was take the Killian documents and marry them to all the official documents I knew about.
Which means you lined them up chronologically.
That's exactly right.
And every single date in the documents you had was consistent with the documents that you got from Burkett, was consistent with the earlier documents you got under the Freedom of Information Act. I don't think people understood that you had a long history with this, and you line them up, and they all fit. There was no contradiction within the
document. There were confirmations.
And confirmations.
You know, I could look back at the Killian document and see a reference that I had sort of overlooked, but by God, that's what it referred to right there. You know, the fact that Bush had gotten additional points in May of 73, and I felt it was a very, very compelling case for these documents having been real.
So there you had all. You're going to, I like to say press, because I'm a print person.
That's okay. That's what we do.
You go to press too?
Sure.
Oh, okay. You go to press, and you've got Hodges.
Mm-hmm.
You've got handwriting, document,
analysis. Mm-hmm.
And you've got
meshing and vetting.
You've got the meshing.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've also got a very good interview with the former lieutenant governor of Texas, who says that he made a call to get Bush in the National Guard, which provides the provenance, that's just in the background, for the story. Let me ask you, would any other journalists have not gone with the story at this point, or is there a good argument you should have waited longer?
I don't know. I mean, the question, I guess, is whether journalism is in such trouble that somebody else wouldn't have gone with it. The difficulty for me, I think the mistake I made was underestimating, or misunderestimating, as the president would say, the toxicity of the political atmosphere. I mean, I knew it was really polarized. I had no idea that there were character assassinations being performed on such a regular basis. And I think now, 15 months in retrospect, we can see that, as in the Joe Wilson, Valerie Plame case, as with so many other people who have in any way taken on this administration, they've basically been decimated.
Okay, now that's part of the blogger's power, and I want to get to that more fully in just a second. But I want to ask you, if there's no provable forgery, if the documents were true as far as we can determine, why were you fired?
Well, that's an interesting question.
So that's why I asked you.
I guess in the report, I was cited for myopic zeal, which I joke in the book was always one of my good points. As an investigative reporter, you got to have a little myopic zeal, or else, you know, you're going to, a long time before, give up. So I guess I was fired for zealously or tenaciously pursuing a story that ultimately made CBS and Viacom feel financially uncomfortable.
You were fired for making Viacom feel, why did it make them feel?
Well, what I was told at the time, one of the executives told me, you know, Mary, do you know how many millions of dollars we spend lobbying in Washington every year, and nothing you've done in the past year has helped? Meaning the story Dan Rather and I broke on Abu Ghraib prison abuse, and now the Bush National Guard story. I think what it did was make it more difficult for Viacom to go to a Republican Congress, to a Republican-directed FCC, and say, we want favorable rulings in, you know, areas of digital television, in cable decency standards, in debt justification, and all kinds of things.
Okay, now let's look at it from the other side. There was a whole panel that justified you're firing for all. You were fired after the panel came out. But
yes.
The panel report justified the firing,
mm-hmm.
Right?
It did.
Okay, so now what's in the panel's report that justified the firing?
I don't know. You know, the panel, Bacardi and Thornburg always said they didn't recommend the firing. That was an independent decision of CBS. I think what they did was sort of, leave the baby out in the wilderness by itself.
Well, let's try this. I don't think this is an easy question to answer. What did the panel conclude in a couple of sentences? Could you tell me?
That the story had been rushed to air.
Rushed.
That I suffered from a very bad case of myopic zeal, and that I had not been entirely forthcoming with my superiors about the vulnerabilities of the documents. I felt very much that I had, but they felt that I had not.
They said in the report that all the procedures of CBS had fallen down. Did you think all the procedures of CBS had fallen down?
After the report aired, absolutely.
No, but they didn't say after the report.
I know.
Well, they did. Actually, they did say after the report.
Right, when the report was defended, briefly.
I think most people would agree that after the report aired, there's a period of time when CBS is clunking around, and that's because of the bloggers. I want to get to that in a
staggering
moment. Yeah. But with respect to the precise finding, They found that the procedures before publication broadcast had not been met.
I know, but you know what? Unlike Dick Thornburg and Lou Bacardi and all the other securities attorneys who looked at this, I've worked at CBS News for 15 years. I won a Peabody for investigative reporting and a number of other awards. I used to be pretty darn good at this, and I actually have experience with it, and I know pretty well what CBS's standards are and procedures. They have awards in that building that I won for them.
Okay, now let me turn it around and say, what do you think of this theory? You were fired because you didn't have a chain of title, a chain of custody with respect to the document itself, the documents themselves. The documents were from Burkett, and Burkett said he got them from another gentleman in Texas who was in Germany. And then when Dan and you sought to reconfirm that statement, he changed his story, and he said they came from a person, mm-hmm. A woman named Gonzalez.
Ramirez. Lucy Ramirez.
Mm-hmm.
I'd love to meet her. Yeah, I think Burkett changing his story was a huge problem. It didn't in any way negate our vetting and meshing and all that other stuff. But I think for CBS, it was seen as a way of staunching the bleeding. Let's stop this.
Okay, well, so you could say that, well, look, you should have spent all your time chasing that down. Right. Going back and back and back and back. What do you think of that criticism?
Well, I think chain of custody is a legal term. It's not something I've ever heard used in newsrooms. Mm-hmm. What we do is get it, determine whether or not the preponderance of evidence, if you want to use some kind of legal analogy, it's whether the preponderance of evidence shows that this is true. I believe Burkett was in a position to get the documents, in part because I saw him only as a conduit for the documents. I did not see him as someone who'd taken them out of the trash or anything like that. But what people outside of Texas maybe don't understand is that in that deep-fried Texas world of politics, there are all these cabals and groups, and there are people who move documents around, and it is a tremendously colorful and fast and fluid environment. And to me, it was thoroughly believable that someone slipped that to Burkett and said, get it to the media.
But suppose if you had known that he were, if you'd gone back to him before broadcast and he said Gonzalez, you would have stopped.
Yes.
So there is an argument that that's why you were fired, but I can't find in.
Well, then I was fired for being lied to.
Yeah.
And sources have lied to reporters for a long time. But look at right. Scooter Libby.
And I, just in your defense on that point, I think it's very unusual for reporters to go back and ask that question. Mm-hmm. I mean, no one went back to Ellsberg and said, "For whom do you get the documents?" You don't. That's not the way the journalism business is. You try to do it by meshing the documents, confirming it, and make your own judgment so you don't have to rely on the guy.
Yeah, you can't rely on someone's word.
Because when documents come from nowhere, if you start getting into that, you're going nowhere. Let me just turn it around further on this point. Who do you think Gonzalez, was there someone named Gonzalez? What did I say, Ramirez?
Ramirez is the name.
Do you think there was a person named Ramirez?
I very honestly think Bill Burkett speaks in sort of cryptic, I think he tells the truth, but he tells his version of the truth, and I write this in the book. Sometimes it's a half-truth. I think it probably is a name he made up to protect someone, and I think he did protect people, and I think he's protecting someone with that name. I think there's a real person who gave him the document.
And how do you think that person got the documents?
I know that in 1997, one of the things I found out, I do have on the record in the book, someone who witnessed a huge scrubbing in 97.
You think they came out of this?
I think they came out of the scrubbing. And the other thing I found is that in looking through these old documents from the Guard, this was an incredible organization built on patronage, political influence, privilege, the well-connected and the, willing to cheat. And this is what this organization was like. And so, in fact, I did find a document showing that then First Lieutenant Bush's commander, Buck Stout, was investigated by the FBI in 1970 for falsifying official documents. That's official record that I have.
Let's talk about the bloggers for a few minutes. How do you think that CBS dealt with the bloggers?
Horribly. I think we were the first and the worst victims of the bloggers. A newspaper in Dallas called these anonymous bloggers the sort of the digital equivalent of the Klan. They wear hoods because they don't want their names out there. So I was being insulted. My veracity was being attacked by somebody named the Big Kahuna. You know, I didn't know who to get mad at first.
And so how do you, I mean, this is, you were the first, but Newsweek had a story on the Quran, flushing the Quran down the toilet.
Right.
They retracted it quickly because they didn't want to get in the position CBS did. But then it turned out the story was true. You can make an argument that Judy Miller, when she decided to seek consent to get out of jail from Libby, or release from the pledge, the bloggers got so furious at her that led to her demise at the New York Times. So we have a pattern. It seems that the bloggers attack mainstream media.
Very much.
And so what do you think, how are we going to deal with this problem? I mean, blogging is now something that is a very serious problem. The French riots are believed to cause.
I know it. Isn't that something?
Some port by bloggers. The bloggers may be a lot more dangerous than any of us wish to admit. So now put your CBS hat on, or put your own hat on. What should have happened?
I think what should have happened is that I think we probably should have had an investigation at CBS, but it should have been done by journalists. It should not have been done by securities attorneys, festive individuals though they are. And that's what I think we should have done. And I think CBS should have also recognized that this was a brand new and very dangerous phenomenon that really reeked of McCarthyism. These bloggers, and I don't care if they're liberal or conservative bloggers, in my case they were all conservative bloggers, but they behaved like 14-year-old boys who'd gotten into their parents' liquor cabinet. They were drunk with power. They were name-calling. They were ugly. They were wilding. They put my home...
That's propaganda. We're dealing with...
Complete.
The same kind of propaganda Hitler.
Well, that's... I mean, we've seen this face before. We really have in society. They put my home address on the internet. People came by and took pictures. They put a picture of me with a laser sight on my head, like a gun sight. This is dangerous.
Do you think CBS... The way this works in the corporate world, I'll tell the viewers, is there's a PR department in corporations that when something's bad going on concerning the corporation, PR people come out and deal with it. Were the PR people set up to deal with this at CBS?
Not in the least. I mean, we had wonderful, sweet people, thoroughly competent, but they're good at answering questions like, how old is Mike Wallace and what's on Wednesday night and who was voted off the island last Tuesday? They are not good at fighting a war, which is what this was.
And therefore, I want to ask you the question. Did the bloggers get CBS and that's what this whole story is about and get you too?
No, I don't think they did. You know what
I think
did? Greed did.
Greed did.
Corporate greed did. Because I think CBS as a news organization could have fought the bloggers, but it couldn't fight its owners. It couldn't fight greed.
And with that, Mary Maves, I want to thank you for coming
thank
by.
Thank you.
And thank you for coming by. And come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.